Hello friends, this time I am recording for you the CA final SCM and PE amendment batch. Please remember, CA final SCM PE of your new syllabus. I am recording amendment batch 3 for you so that it will help you for the forthcoming exam. Now, for whom this batch is meant and what I am going to discuss in this batch. So let us discuss today in the first lecture. So today's lecture is, you can say, lecture 1. There will be few more lectures to cover this. First of all, this batch is meant only for the students of regular batch. It means those who have already completed a regular batch from me or from elsewhere also, or you have finished your studies of your CA final, SCM and PE syllabus once, at least once, complete study. Then only you can understand what I am discussing. Otherwise, you won't be able to understand the discussion. This is point number one, that those who have completed the studies, regular studies, for them only this batch will be useful. Second point, whatever I'm going to discuss here, this is in this PDF file. Please remember, I'm going to discuss everything. This is a PDF file. Please remember, this PDF file is available on this website which I have put up here, www.carakeshagrawal.in. So you have to first visit this website. On this website, you will go to a section called Student Corner. There is a section called Student Corner. So on this website, you will go to the section of Students Corner. From there, you can download this Amendment Batch 3 PDF file and take the printout. Mind well, I am saying take the printout and get it spiral binded. It's around, you will notice it's around 118 pages of notes and plus few extra pages like index page and preface and so on. So actually there are 121 pages, but the text matter is contained in 118 pages. So get the spiral binded notes like this, right? Like this. So get it printed and get it spiral binded so that it will be useful to you when I do the discussion, because questions are printed here as well as solutions are also printed there. So that will help you in revising the subject, and you don't have to write because I have already printed the answer. Questions and answers are printed one below another, so you don't have to write anything. However, for understanding purpose, you will sit with calculator, rough pages, few rough pages, calculator, pen, right? So what you should do before you start viewing this batch further, right? If you are viewing without preparation, you may close down this video. You can first take the printout of this PDF file where I said it is available on my website under the section of Student Corner. From there, you will download this PDF file of Amendment Batch 3. Take the printout and get it spiral binded. So you should have this printed copy of notes with you, first of all. Then you will sit with calculator, rough pages, and pen. And you should have completed the regular studies at least once. And now you are ready for this. Now, what is the purpose of recording this batch? Actually, due to all of you are aware, due to COVID-19 situation, I could not conduct this batch in the classroom. Otherwise, I would have recorded it in the classroom in front of the students. So I'm trying to record it at my home on this PDF file itself. So I'll be explaining using this same PDF file which you have downloaded and printed. And I will discuss all the practical questions which are contained in this Amendment Batch 3 so that it will be helpful to you to understand it little better. Lot many students have already downloaded and studied it on their own. No problem at all. What I'm going to discuss, instead of discussing the theoretical portion, which you can also read because questions and answers are printed, so I'm not going to cover theory or I'm not going to read out theory basically, but I will touch upon the practical questions. I'll explain how the calculations are performed, though the answers are already been printed. But sometimes some students demand for explanation that how the calculations have been done, what is the logic. Sometimes students don't read the question carefully. So I'll be going through these questions and I'll be explaining the answers which are already printed in the PDF notes. So it will help you to revise the subject also. With that intention, I'm recording this batch. Now let us first of all see what we are going to cover in this amendment batch 3. And let me tell you one more thing. First of all, in this subject, there are no amendments like direct taxes and indirect taxes. But still, I give the name as amendment batches because students love to call it as amendment batch. Really speaking, there is no amendment. There are only additional questions which I am going to cover in this amendment batch. Now, what we are going to cover is printed in the index page itself in this batch. Check what I am going to cover. At serial number 1, I have written suggested answer of May 2019 exam. So, I am going to cover that. Suggested answer of May 2019 exam, questions and answers. Mainly, my focus will be on practical questions and I will be only explaining the calculations to you. After completing that, we will switch over to number 2, that is suggested answer of November 2019 exam. Right? Then, I will go to the questions from RTP. RTP which was meant for November 2019 exam. And the RTP which was meant for May 2020 exam. And all of you are aware, this May 2020 exam itself did not take place due to Corona or COVID-19 situation. So exam has not happened. The next exam due is November 2020. May 2020 exam didn't take place. So two RTPs and two suggested answers I'll be covering. And plus, lastly, we'll be covering some additional questions, some case studies and case scenarios and some questions from mock test papers which are uploaded on ICAI website, which are uploaded on ICAI website during the period, during this period, that is during 1st May 2019 to 30th April 2020. During this period, whatever additional questions, case studies, case scenarios, mock test papers are uploaded on the website, that I'm going to cover over here. Now, if anybody has a question, what about the questions, additional questions covered by institute before 1st May 2019? So, my dear friend, these are either covered in amendment batch 2 or amendment batch 1. Are you getting it? This is the third batch. So, I have already covered a lot of portion in amendment batch 1 as well as amendment batch 2. Those PDF files are also available on the same website you will find. Okay. So you'll find, actually, if you visit this website, carakeshagarwal.in, you'll find three amendment batch notes there, 1, 2, and 3. Out of which my version 3 of regular batch already covers the contents of amendment batch 1 and 2. Please remember, my version 3 regular batch students should note that in version 3, I have already covered the questions from amendment batch 1 and amendment batch 2. So, students of my version 3, they have to just refer to only this batch, amendment batch 3. So, version 3, regular batch version 3 plus amendment batch 3, you may say it is as good as version 4 batch now. I repeat, regular batch of version 3 plus amendment batch 3, which I am discussing now, is as good as your version 4. So, let's go ahead with friends. I think you are ready with all the setup and necessary things. I am starting with suggested answer of May 2019 exam and I will be discussing the practical part, practical questions only. This is about me, I have written. So, let's go ahead. This is preface to amendment batch 3, which you can read as per your leisure time. And let us start from here, right? I'll be discussing from this PDF file itself, which you already have with you in the printed form now. This was May 2019 exam question 1. Please remember, question 1 was for 20 marks and this was a case study. This was a case study. So, I'm not going to read out the case study now. And all of you are aware, question 1 is compulsory and you have to solve any 4 questions out of remaining 5. So, in all there are 6 questions, including sub questions sometimes. So, in all there are 6 questions out of which 1 is compulsory and out of remaining 5 you have to solve any 4. This pattern you know. So, this question was a case study. This case study was based on the concept of value chain analysis, if you remember, of Michael Porter. Value chain analysis, primary activities, secondary activities, if you know, plus balance scorecard and performance prism. Balance scorecard and performance prism are the methods of evaluation of performance. So balance scorecard and performance prism. So on these three concepts, this case study is based. So you may go through this case study as well as answer. I am taking you to practical questions, and that too the calculations only. So I am just going ahead. This is 20 marks case study, and then you will find the answer is also printed here. Like, so here the answer starts, I think. Right, from here the answer starts of that question. I'll take you to, so this I am not reading out because it will be boring for you also. Instead of me reading out, you can read it at home. The theory part, you can read and understand at home. I am taking this question number 2, which is a little practical question. So let us first understand the question. Amber Limited is a leading company in a footwear industry. The company has 4 factories in different locations with state-of-the-art equipment, that is modern equipments. Due to competition in the market, company is continually reviewing its product range and enhancing its existing products by developing new models to satisfy the demands of the customer. So this company is in a footwear industry, please remember. And it has got 4 factories. The company currently has a production facility which has a capacity of 3,500 standard hours. The capacity, production capacity, is 3,500 standard hours per week, right? This is just like a key factor, you can say. So your capacity to produce is 3,500 standard hours. Product comfort was introduced in the market 6 months ago. This product was introduced in the market 6 months ago. Which one? Comfort. And is now about to enter the maturity stage of its life cycle. So here the question seems to be on product life cycle. If you remember, there are 5 stages of product life cycle. Try to recollect. First one is introduction, then growth, then maturity. Maturity is also called as saturation, then decline, and then deletion. So there's 5 stages. So this product has now entered in the maturity phase of the life cycle. In maturity phase, the competition intensifies, if you remember, right? However, research by the marketing department indicates that demand of the product comfort in the market is price sensitive. This demand of this product is price sensitive. It means the price elasticity of demand will apply in this. There is the principle of economics, which is very common. If you charge a lower price, the quantity sold will increase. And if you charge higher price, the quantity sold will be lower. That is called, the demand is price sensitive. The likely market response are as follows. So you are provided here with the selling price per unit, and here the sales demand per week only. And see, the capacity was also given for a week only. And data is also sales demand per week in units. Now you will notice at a sales price of 1750, the demand is 550 units per week. Now, if you reduce the sales price to 1600, the demand will go up from 550, it will jump to 725. If you reduce the sales price further to 1525, the demand will jump from 725 to 1000 rupees. This is quantity demanded, and so on. So you will notice as the sales price goes on reducing, the quantity sold keeps on increasing with reduction in sales price. The lowest sales price given to us is 1300 for the footwear, and the highest demand per week is 1200 units. Let's go ahead, friends. The variable cost per unit of manufacturing comfort is ₹750. This is per unit variable cost of comfort. And standard hours used to manufacture one unit is 2 hours. It means the product comfort requires 2 hours to produce one unit. Now the story is taking a twist. or a turn further, the product sports, this is a different one. Product sports was introduced to the market 2 months ago. This was introduced 2 months ago, and Comfort was introduced 6 months ago. So the product sports was introduced to the market 2 months ago using penetration pricing policy. This product followed the penetration pricing. You know, in penetration pricing, we charge low sales price first and then we keep on increasing the price. So this product is following the penetration pricing policy and is now about to enter the growth stage. This product is about to enter the growth stage. Which one? Sports. And Comfort is about to enter into maturity phase. Please remember. So this product is different. See here, the Comfort is about to enter the maturity stage and Sports is the product which is about to enter the growth stage. Now each unit, a variable cost of rupees 525 means on each unit we incur a variable cost of 545. This is for Sports and takes 2.5 standard hours to produce. This product requires 2.5 standard hours to produce. So each unit has a variable cost of 545 and it takes 2.5 standard hours to produce. Now market research has indicated that there is a linear relationship between selling price and number of units demanded. You know, again, linear relationship is same price elasticity of demand, and the demand will be increasing in the direct proportion to decrease in sales price. That is what we call as linear relationship between the selling price and the number of units demanded, and the of the form of this P is equal to A minus BX. If you remember profit maximization model which we had discussed, in that profit maximization model this price is calculated as price is equal to A minus 2BX. Now this is for Sports. At a price of rupees 1000 per unit, the demand is expected to be 1000 units per week. At a price of rupees 1000 per unit, the demand is also expected to be 1000 per week. And for every rupees 100 increase in selling price, the weekly demand will reduce by 200 units. This is the elasticity of demand. For every 100 rupees increase in selling price, the demand will decrease naturally, decrease by 200 units. And for every 100 rupees decrease in selling price, if you decrease the selling price, the demand will increase. The weekly demand will increase by 200 units. So for Sports, what will happen? For every 100 rupees increase in price, the quantity demanded will decrease by 200 units. And for every decrease of 100 rupees in selling price, the demand will increase by 200 units. Now we are moving to the third one. Product Ethnic is currently being developed and which is about to be launched. It is not yet launched. It is about to be launched into the market. So it will go into the introduction phase if it is launched into the market. So there are three products, my dear friends. First was Comfort, which is entering into maturity stage. Sports is entering into a growth stage, and Ethnic, if introduced, will go into introduction phase. Now this is a highly innovative designer product which the company believes that it will have a revolutionary impact. If you remember, in case of revolutionary products, you charge a very high price in the beginning. So it will have a revolutionary impact on the market and the consumer behavior. The company has decided to use the market skimming approach, that is skimming pricing policy. Naturally, if it's a revolutionary product, you can charge a very high price. In skimming pricing, we charge very high price in the beginning and then we keep on reducing the price. That is skimming pricing policy. And penetration pricing policy is one where we charge very low price and then we increase the price. So the company has decided to use the market skimming approach to pricing this product during the introduction stage. So product Ethnic will follow skimming pricing and product Sports will follow penetration pricing. Now let's go ahead. Let us see what are the questions. Total 20 marks. First, question A1. Advise which of the above five selling prices should be charged for product comfort. This is the question for comfort. In order to maximize its contribution during its maturity stage. We'll go one by one, let us say, so that there is no confusion. Total marks, you will notice it's a question for 3 marks, then 5, 4, and then 8. So you'll find it is total 20 marks. Okay. Now let's go one by one. Question A1, which is very simple according to me. Out of the 5 selling prices, the question is asking that which price you should charge for comfort during maturity stage. So I'll explain from the question itself. My dear friends, you might have noticed the answer is printed below here. The solution is here. Instead of going here, I'll take you up. What should be the approach to solve the question? I'm going taking you to the question. See, these are 5 selling prices given to you in this table. And the variable cost of comfort is how much? 750. What we have to do? Just selling price minus variable cost per unit. Selling price per unit minus variable cost per unit 750. You will get contribution per unit. Contribution per unit into quantity demanded, sales demand per week. So you'll get weekly contribution. Now, out of these 5 sales prices, at whichever price the total contribution is maximum, that sales price you will select. So the first question is that only. Advise which of the above 5 selling prices would be charged for the product comfort. So I'll just take you to the answer now. It's a very simple question. See here, I have taken this sales units per week copy pasted, selling price per unit copy pasted from the previous table, variable cost per unit is same for all sales prices, and difference between selling price and variable cost is your contribution per unit. Contribution per unit multiplied by number of units, you will get total contribution. Now you can, on your calculator, you can check it. Now you'll find total contribution is maximum here. 8,05,000 at a sales price, selling price is 1,450 and the quantity is 1,150 units. So our advice, it's written here, the total contribution is maximum when sales are 1,150 units. This is a weekly demand. Therefore, the selling price of comfort should be 1,450 per unit. So this is the answer of question 1A. I'll go back. Let us check this question, A2. Calculate the number of units to be produced of the product sports. This is about the second product, sports, and third was ethnic. So calculate the number of units to be produced of the product sports in order to utilize all the spare capacity from your answer to one above. And the selling price per unit of the product sport during the growth stage. Actually, there are 2 questions in it. One, you have to calculate the number of units to be produced using the spare capacity. Spare capacity from your answer one above. It means after producing comfort, whatever capacity is left in that spare capacity, how many units we can produce of sports? That is question 1, quantity. And then you have to calculate the selling price per unit at which sports should be sold. And you will notice here the marks are 2 plus 3, 5. It means 2 marks are for calculation of quantity. This is for number of units. And 3 marks are for calculation of your selling price. This selling price per unit, right, for this. So 3 marks for selling price and 2 marks for number of units. Now, if you remember this, check here, this product sports, for this a formula is given. This is a profit maximization model. We'll have to use this formula and this information at 1000 rupees sales price, the quantity demanded is 1000 units and the price elasticity is, for every 100 rupees, there is a fluctuation in quantity by 200 units. This information we'll have to use. Now, before going to the answer, let us discuss what we'll have to do. How much was your total capacity? Somewhere in the question it was written. Your total capacity is 3500 standard hours. From these 3500 standard hours, we'll have to deduct the capacity used for manufacture of comfort. Now, you'll notice comfort requires 2 standard hours per unit. And our decision was to produce how many units? 1150 units, correct? 1150 units at the sales price. So we will deduct the capacity utilized by comfort. From remaining capacity, or in remaining capacity, we will produce sports. And for sports, the time given was, if you remember here, the time given was 2.5 hours per unit. And the variable cost of sports is 545. Okay. I hope you have captured this data. So should I go to the answer now? This is the figure. This is the data which we'll be using. If you want, you can refer from your printed notes also. You can keep the question open in front of you. I'm taking you to the solution. From 3500 hours, we'll deduct the capacity used by comfort. And in the remaining capacity, we will manufacture sports. Remaining capacity divided by 2.5 hours. In 2.5 hours, if you produce 1 unit, in remaining hours, how many units we can produce? Then we'll go to that profit maximization model, from where we will calculate the sales price using that formula, P is equal to A minus BX. So I'll now take you to the solution below. From there, I will explain. Check. So Amber Limited has a production capacity of 3500 hours per week. Now, as explained in the first answer, we would manufacture 1150 units of comfort each week, and each unit of comfort requires 2 hours. So 1150 into 2, thus you will be using 2300 hours per week. 2300 hours gone. Now what is the capacity left? The production capacity remaining now to manufacture sports is your total 3500 hours minus 2300 hours used by comfort. So 1200 hours per week are left for you. And each unit of sports require 2.5 hours. So 1200 hours divided by 2.5. So 1200 divided by 2.5 hours means you can produce 480 units per week. So we got the quantity which we can produce in the remaining capacity. So this is the quantity which we got for sports. Now we have to use this relationship. So I'll take you to this linear relationship between selling price and number of units, which is given by this formula. Now, where this P is the price, that is selling price per unit, which we are asked to calculate. The price quantity we have already calculated as 480 units. Please remember, using that quantity, we'll calculate the price for 3 marks. Now, A is the selling price at which the demand becomes zero. The sales price at which demand becomes zero. We'll calculate that sales price. Don't worry. B is the cost slope. That cost slope is calculated as change in price upon change in quantity. That is the how much is the fluctuation in price due to fluctuation in quantity. And this X is the quantity itself. In the classroom, if I remember, we had used the letter Q there for quantity. Institute has used X. X is the quantity demanded. Now, quantity demanded, we have got this 480. So this answer we already know, quantity demanded 480. So we'll substitute 480 in this equation. We'll substitute the value of A and B, and we'll automatically get the price. Okay. So we have to just substitute the correct data. Now, given that at a selling price of 1000 per unit, this was given already, the quantity demanded is 1000 units. 1000 selling price per unit, 1000 quantity demanded. And for every 100 rupees per unit increase or decrease in selling price, the quantity demanded fluctuates by 200 units. Now, from here, we'll get this value B also. You'll find the change in price or fluctuation in price is 100, and the quantity fluctuates by 200. So 100 divided by 200 is 0.5. That is the value of B. It means if you increase the price, sales price by 0.5, the quantity demanded will decrease by 1 unit now, because 100 divided by 200 you are doing. Rupees 100 divided by 200 units. So you'll get fluctuation per unit, price fluctuation for each unit. So if you increase the price by 0.5, the quantity will decrease by 1. If you further increase the price by 0.5, the quantity demanded will decrease further by 1. Are you getting it? That is the value of B. Simply speaking, for 100 rupees, for 100 rupees fluctuation, the quantity demanded fluctuates by 200. So this relationship, 100 divided by 200, so you'll get price per unit. Now check here, a rupees 500, now this is important for you to know, a 500 rupees per unit increase in selling price will result in a fall of 1000 units per week. Now from where we have calculated this, this is important. This is important to get the value of A. I want the value of A, that is the selling price at which the demand becomes zero. Now, if you have noticed that for quantity 200, the price should fluctuate by 100 rupees. And your demand given to in the question is 1000 units at 1000 rupees. 1000 units is the demand at 1000 rupees. Now, I want the price at which quantity will become zero. So if from demand of 1000 units, I want to come down to zero. It means if I want to reduce my quantity by 1000 units, how much should be the fluctuation in price? For 200 quantity fluctuation 100 rupees, so for 1000 it will be rupees 500. Now if I increase the price by 500 per unit, the quantity will decrease by 1000. I repeat, if I increase the price by 500 rupees, quantity will decrease by 1000. So from this 1000, if quantity decreases by 1000, it will become zero. So quantity will become zero if price increases by 500. From which base price? 1000 rupees base price per unit. So 1000 rupees base price per unit is given to you, plus increase of 500 rupees per unit. It means if our sales price becomes 1500, the entire demand of 1000 units will vanish. It means demand will become zero at a sales price of rupees 1500. You have to simply use that mathematical equation. Okay, so this 1500 is the value of A. Means if you keep a sales price of 1500, demand will become zero. And at a sales price of rupees 1000, the demand will be 1000 units, and so on. As you decrease the sales price, quantity demanded will increase. And this is the value of B, that is change in price upon change in quantity, that is 100 upon 200, that is 0.5. Okay. Now, using that formula, so what was important to calculate value A, that is the price at which demand becomes zero, using this. For how much fluctuation in quantity, what is the change in price? Using that, you have to calculate the value of A. Now we'll substitute the data here. Now again, in this formula, A's value we calculated just now, 1500, the price at which demand becomes zero. The value of B, this one, is 0.5. For 0.5 reduction in sales price per unit, the quantity increases by 1. And we wanted to sell how many units? 480 units. So for selling 480 units, you have to decrease the price by 480 into 0.5. That is, you have to decrease the price by 240. So from 1500, where the sales will be zero, you have to decrease the price by 240 to sell 480 units. It means your sales price should be 1260. So, at 1260 sales price, you can sell how many units? 480. And 480 units you will be able to produce using the spare capacity after producing comfort. Is that clear, my dear friends? Everything is given here. But you should know the profit maximization model for this. I'll take you back to the remaining questions there. Now, what are the remaining questions? Let us see. I think it seems to be theory questions now. Question B is compare the penetration pricing and skimming pricing strategies during the introduction stage using the product Ethnic to illustrate your answer. Ethnic, you are aware of, Ethnic is a new product about to be launched, so it will enter in the introduction stage. And they are just telling you to compare the penetration and skimming pricing. Basically, you have to give the difference between penetration and skimming pricing, right? Penetration pricing, we have discussed, it goes from lower price to higher price. Skimming pricing, higher to lower in different situations. So again, a theory question, answer is printed. You can see that. And I'll take you to question C now. Question C is explain with reasons for each stages of ethnic's product life cycle. Ethnic is a new product to be launched. The changes that would be expected in average unit production cost and unit selling price. Unit production cost means production cost per unit. Unit selling price means selling price per unit. Now try to understand this question. Read it again. See, they are asking you the explanation with reasons that for each stage of ethnic's product life cycle, each stage, how the changes will take place in average production cost per unit and average selling price. Now, I'll just discuss in brief, answer is printed. Now, check here. First of all, for ethnic. See, for ethnic, I think we had decided to use skimming pricing approach. So what will happen? First, you will charge higher price and then lower price. Is that okay? And it is in the introduction phase and it's a revolutionary product. It means you have spent a lot of money on research development. So one thing is clear, ethnic product will be launched at a higher price and then the price will go on reducing. So the impact on unit selling price is simple. It will move from higher to lower because the strategy has already been decided, skimming pricing. So price will move from higher to lower. That on those lines you'll have to give the answer. See, in the beginning it's a revolutionary product, so there is price elasticity of demand doesn't exist, so people are ready to pay a higher price, but slowly the competition will come in and then you'll have to lower the price. Please remember, you have to explain this for all stages of product life cycle. It means you'll have to give the change in production cost and change in selling price at every stage. Like at introduction stage, what will happen, at growth stage, what will happen, at maturity stage and at decline stage. Okay. So you'll have to give it for all the stages. Changes taking place in selling price. So selling price will go on continuously decreasing. Now, what about unit production cost at each stage? So as it's a revolutionary product, you must have spent more money in the beginning. So your production cost per unit will be higher in the beginning. And in the beginning, as you are following skimming pricing, the quantity demanded is also lower. So your fixed cost burden, as quantity demanded is lower, the fixed cost per unit burden goes up. So your average production cost will be higher in the beginning. Then as you enter the growth phase and maturity phase, what happens that you get the benefit of the scale of production, large scale of production. Plus there is an effect of learning curve of labor and quantity demanded goes on increasing. So fixed cost per unit, the fixed cost burden per unit, I'm saying, goes on decreasing. Total fixed cost remains the same, but it gets divided over more number of units. And due to economies of scale of production, your cost goes on decreasing. As you buy more raw material in higher quantity, the supplier may also offer the discount. So the price will also move from higher to lower. But when you reach to the maturity and decline phase, your quantity demanded goes on decreasing again. So you will lose the discount on input material, right? The learning effect also might have gone and you'll have to spend more money on marketing or substitute products. So your cost may again start going up. So that is how the cost, production cost will also move from higher to lower and then again will go up. But selling price will continuously move from higher to lower. On these lines, you will find the answer, which is printed, which you can go through. So I'm moving to the next question now. Answers are already printed. So you have to be very careful in writing the answer and you should know the theory well. Therefore, if you remember, I had discussed in my regular batches that you should be good at theory, conceptually. You have to understand theory so that you can write the answer in your own words. Here is the answer C, that is impact on unit selling price and average production cost per unit at each stage, introduction, growth, maturity, and decline. Okay, so we'll move to this question number 3 now. Question 3. Excel Limited is a leading manufacturer and exporter of high quality leather products. And there are two products, product A and product B. Selling price per unit of product A and product B is given to you as rupees 620 and 420. Selling price of A is 620. Selling price of product B is 420 and these are leather products. leather goods, could be anything. Now both the products pass through three processes. Both these products have to pass through three processes. And what are these three processes? Tanning. In leather industry, you know these words are used. Tanning, it's to get the leather. Then dyeing, that is giving it a color. And then finishing. A product which is manufactured using this leather has to be finished. So during manufacturing processes, allocation of cost per unit. Allocation of cost per unit of leather products manufactured among the processes are given below. Now this is what we have to understand, what they are saying. This, the question says cost per unit. Now check it carefully. There are three processes: tanning, dyeing and finishing. Direct material per unit is 140, 180, 140 in three processes, total is 460. And direct labor cost per unit is 90, 120 and 90 for three processes, total 300. And cost allocation is given to product A and B. Now here you have to check it like this. For tanning process, you have to allocate the cost to product A and B as 70-30. Now here itself, I'll make something clear to you before reading the further question. Actually, this 140 rupees, you have to split between A and B in the ratio 70%, 30%. This is the meaning. Material cost also. And this 90 rupees labor cost also, you will split as 70% and 30%. And you will get per unit cost of A and B. Now see, there could be an wrong interpretation from the question. The question says this cost is for one unit. Actually, really speaking, this cost is for one unit of A plus one unit of B. Are you able to understand what I'm saying? The cost given to you in the question is for one unit of A plus B. Actually, this cost is for two units together. So 140 rupees is this 140 rupees is the material cost of one unit of A plus one unit of B. And which you will split as 70% to A and 30% to B. Labor cost also will split the same in the same manner. Similarly, your dyeing cost of material 180, you will split as 50-50. And dyeing labor cost 120 rupees also you will split as 50-50% for dyeing process. And for finishing process again, you will split this cost as 70-30. Actually, the wordings of the questions are wrong according to me. So it's a cost of two units together of A and B, which you have to split. Now, if I go strictly by the wordings of the question, strictly, see what will happen. You have the calculator with you. If I treat it as cost of only one unit of A, so one unit of A's cost is 460 material plus 300 labor. How much it will become? 760. And what is the selling price? 620. So you'll be suffering a loss. Similarly, 760 will also become the cost of product B also. And what is the selling price? 420. So there is no point in solving the question. Therefore, I said this total together, material plus labor, 760 is the cost of one unit of A plus one unit of B. That is how you have to interpret. And this 760 rupees you will split between product A and B. Okay, should we go ahead now? This is about direct material, direct labor. That is about prime cost. Now we'll read about overheads. Now general overheads per unit of leather product manufactured. General overheads per unit manufactured is rupees 230, which is again allocated equally between A and B. So 230 will also become allocated equally. So once again, 230 is the cost of A plus B together. So half half, if you do half, you will get cost of one unit of A and half you will get cost of overhead cost of one unit of B. This is about overheads. And please remember, material and labor was prime cost. It was direct material, direct labor, and this is overheads. And now you'll get the total cost. Now the above cost allocation is the basis for the decisions regarding pricing of the product. This cost allocation, which is given to us, the percentage is given for prime cost and the equal bifurcation of overhead cost is the basis for pricing decision. Now, in this industry, all the major production processes have environmental impact at all stages of process, including general waste. Now, naturally, in leather industry, there is a lot of pollution. So there is an environmental impact at all the stages of production. There are three stages given to us, which are those: tanning, dyeing and finishing. and the impact is of generation of waste, emission of harmful gases and noise pollution, water containment. These are the impacts, environmental impacts of this production. I mean to say the question is moving towards your environmental management accounting, it seems, right? Let's go ahead. The management of the company is worried about the above environmental impact and has taken initiative to preserve the environment, like research and development activities aimed at reducing pollution level, planting trees, treatment of harmful gases and airborne emissions, wastewater treatment, etc. So company is going to take certain efforts to reduce the environmental impact. The management of the company desires to adopt environmental management accounting. So here it has come, environmental management accounting, as a part of strategic decision making process. Pricing of product should also factor in the environmental cost. So they are thinking of factoring the environmental cost in calculation of the product cost. Now, general overheads per unit of the leather product manufactured are 230, which includes. So same 230 rupees which was given above, they have given you the breakup of 230 rupees. That 230 rupees includes treatment cost of harmful gases 80 rupees, wastewater treatment cost 100 rupees and cost of planting trees 20 rupees. Any further breakup? No. So in 230, the breakup is 80 rupees spent on treatment of harmful gases, 100 on wastewater and on planting trees 20. So this total will become 200, correct? So breakup of 200 is given, means how much is still left? 30 rupees is still left. So breakup of 200 is available, 30 rupees breakup is not available, and 200 plus 30 will become 230. So out of overheads, you have got some breakup, some cost for which reason is not given. So we'll treat as miscellaneous overheads or general overheads. Let's go ahead. Process wise information related to generation of wastewater and harmful gases is given below. Now, process wise, please remember this data is process wise, is not product wise. Process wise information is given about the generation of wastewater and harmful gases. Wastewater generated is given in liters per week. This is data in liters per week, not rupees. Liters per week is 900, 600, and for finishing process, there is no. And emission of harmful gases is cc per, that is, could be some cubic centimeter or something. CC per week, 400, 300, 100 and 800. And how to allocate this cost between A and B now? That ratio is again given, same ratio, 70-30, 50-50 and 70-30. The remaining overheads cost and cost of planting trees. Remaining overhead cost we had calculated 30 rupees and cost of planting trees given above. Cost of planting trees 20 rupees, okay? Can be allocated equally between product A and B. Okay, this what is the data given to you. Now let us see the question and then we'll discuss. See, the first question is required. This question is again for 20 marks, it seems. 2 plus 5 plus 2 plus 8 plus 3, okay? Out of which we'll pick up question A. Calculate the product-wise profitability based on original cost allocation, original. And then B question is recalculate the product wise profitability based on activity based costing is one of the method which we use in environmental management accounting. So first two questions, my dear friends, are simply calculate the cost using your original cost allocation and then calculate the revised cost and profitability using activity based costing. As answers are printed ahead, I will just discuss from above, see what we'll have to do. And please remember, when you change the method, there will be only change in allocation of overheads. Prime cost won't change, only there will be a change in overheads calculation. So first of all, my dear friends, in order to calculate and to calculate profitability, you'll have to deduct the cost from your sales price and you'll get the profit. Sales prices are given here. Just check. I have taken you back to the question. Selling price is 620 and 420 given here. Now you have to deduct the cost, out of which I have already discussed with you. I'll discuss again about certain costs. Check here. calculations you already have with you. See, this 140 rupees material cost of tanning, you will divide as 70-30. Okay, direct material. This 180, you will divide as 50-50. This 140, you will divide as 70-30. This is direct material cost. You got splitted between product A, B. Similarly, you will also divide or split this cost, labor cost, that is 90 rupees also in 70-30, 120 rupees in 50-50 proportion, 90 rupees in 70-30 proportion. You will distribute between A and B, and you will take the total, that is material plus labor. What will happen? You will get prime cost. Material, direct material plus direct labor, you will get prime cost per unit of A and prime cost per unit of B. Okay, then you will take these overheads, general overheads, which are apportioned equally. These general overheads. This is 230. So 230 you have to just split equally between the two products. So prime cost plus overheads, you will get your product cost. Product cost deducted from selling price, and you will get profitability. At the most, you can explain the profit as percentage to sales price. This will be the answer of question 1. Are you getting it? Answer is printed. You can go ahead. This is the answer of question 1. Now, to give the answer of question 2, what you have to do? Your prime cost, which we just now discussed, will remain the same. Only there will be a change in overheads. So, these overheads bifurcation will change using activity-based costing. Now, see, this 80 rupees is the, this 80 rupees is the overheads cost of, I repeat, prime cost will remain same for both the products A and B, which we calculated earlier. Only allocation of overheads will change. This 80 rupees is the cost for treatment of harmful gases. Now, what you will do? For treatment, emission of harmful gases is in this ratio. So, this, how much is the cost? 80 rupees per unit. So, this 80 rupees cost, you will split in this ratio. 400 is to 300 is to 100, first of all. This you will split between three activities or three processes, tanning, dyeing and finishing. And then the tanning cost will be further divided in the ratio 70 is to 30 between product A and B. So, you have to do two calculations. First, this 80 rupees incurred on emission of gases will be apportioned between three processes, tanning, dyeing and finishing. And then it will be further reapportioned in the ratio or percentage given, 70-30 for tanning, 50-50 for dyeing and 70-30 for finishing. Similarly, for wastewater generated, see, this is the cost of wastewater treatment, 100 rupees. This 100 rupees which is given here, I hope your attention is there. This is the 100 rupees cost. This 100 rupees cost, you will use this cost driver, that is wastewater generated. So, this 100 rupees cost you will split between three processes in the ratio 9 is to 6 is to 0. It is basically finishing process won't get that cost, only tanning and dye. And after that, again, you will split it in the further in 70-30 and 50-50 for these two overheads. Now, cost of planting trees here, 20 rupees for this 20 rupees. For cost of planting trees, they have said cost of planting trees to be distributed equally. And the remaining overhead cost, this 30 rupees, also you will distribute equally between product A and B. And after these overheads are redistributed, you will add it to the prime cost and you will get the revised cost. And cost deducted from selling price, you will get the profit per unit. Profit per unit divided by selling price, you will get the profit as percentage of sales. So, this is the way you will have to do the calculation. Right? Answers are printed, so you can go through. And then what is the third question? C question. C question says, analyze the difference in the product profitability as per both the methods. So, once you calculate the profit as per method A and B, right, then observing these two profits, you will notice where the profit goes up and where the profit goes down, and then you'll have to analyze and write down the differences for 2 marks. Question D. So, that's a theory part. Question D is, recommend and explain the 4 management accounting techniques for the identification and allocation of environmental costs. So, this is a theory question. You've got those 4 methods. I think the flow method is one, then input-output method is one, activity-based costing method is another one, right? And product life cycle costing is one more method. So, that's a theory part. So, you have to explain those 4 accounting techniques to account for the environmental costs, that is environmental management accounting, and E part is state why the management of environmental cost is becoming increasingly important in the organization and give reasons. Naturally, in today's era, the environmental costs are becoming more and more important. So you'll have to state why these costs are becoming important and give reasons. So basically, I would say three questions are theory questions. These three questions are theory questions, out of which question C is based on the calculation which we'll perform in A and B. And D and E are almost purely theory questions. It's a combination of practical plus theory questions. Lot of working is given below. Now here, I'm just giving my opinion. I have written it here for you. Answer 3. Now, this is my personal opinion that this question should be kept as optional one because there are a lot of calculations. So, because it's a lengthy question and it will consume a lot of time. A and B question itself will consume a lot of time because you'll have to apportion the cost and then theory answer also you have to write. So, there are too many things are asked for 20 marks. Actually, in 20 marks, they have asked too many things. So, it will consume a lot of your time. And we have got some simple questions ahead. This is my personal opinion, my dear friends. If somebody finds this question easy, they can solve it. See, you have to solve 4 out of remaining 5 questions after the first question being compulsory. So out of remaining 5, my personal opinion is you should skip question 3 and there are simple questions which will consume lesser time ahead. And all this working is given, my dear friends. This product-wise profitability is calculated. Right. You can later on check on the calculator. This is the direct cost allocation I have done process wise for direct material, direct labor. And then using activity based costing again, this profitability is calculated, which is different. And this is general over is apportioned using activity based costing. You have to go through carefully, right? That what has been done. So I'm not taking you here again. Right. Actually, calculations involved are more, so it will consume more time and presentation of answer also has to be there. And these are the answers to theory questions, that is analysis of difference, product profitability, then 4 techniques, that is input output analysis, flow cost accounting, right, life cycle costing and activity based costing. And then reasons why the environmental costs are becoming more important in the organization, right? My dear friends, I think I'll stop for the day here itself, right? There are some more questions which we'll be discussing in future lectures. So remaining we'll see tomorrow. So we'll be starting from here, question 4A, right? That I'll discuss in my next lecture. Okay, friends, bye-bye. I hope this discussion or explanation will be helpful to you in understanding the questions and answers of Amendment Batch 3. Okay, friends, bye-bye.